Last week, we embarked on a brand new series. The series is called On Fire. It's a study of the early followers of Jesus in a book in the New Testament. You know, the Bible, of course, is a library of books. It's divided primarily into the Hebrew scriptures, which we call the Old Testament, and the Christian scriptures, which we call the New Testament. And in the beginning of the New Testament, you have the four biographies of the life and ministry of Jesus. You have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And then you have this book of church history, this early church history. What happened from the time that Jesus gave his last words to his apostles and then he ascended into heaven? What happened from that time all the way down to 30 years later when the missionary, the great apostle to the Gentiles, a man named Paul of Tarsus, he is now imprisoned in Rome, but he is evangelizing and sharing his faith in Christ with anyone who would listen to him freely and unhindered. That's how the book of Acts ends. So we want to study the life of these early followers of Jesus. We want to learn about their faith. We want to be able to imitate their faith. Because it says in the Bible, it says, remember your leaders, those who went before you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. And so let's look at these early Christ followers. We remember last week when I asked you the famous Bible trivia question. You said, how can you stump your friends at a party? With a Bible trivia question. The question is, what were the last words that Jesus said before he ascended into heaven? And these last words happen also to be the very words that are the key verse to understanding this entire book of Acts in the New Testament. It happens to be Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, right before Jesus left this earth. He told his followers and he says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, which happened to be the city in which they were residing at that time. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the very ends of the earth. And so these early Christ followers, from the moment they watched Jesus ascend up into the sky on the Mount of Olives, and they said, oh boy, our leader just left us. Now what? Somebody joked last week, and he said, Jim, you should have said when they were on the Mount of Olives at the end, you should have said Jesus' last words were not this Acts chapter 1, verse 8. You should have said it was, beam me up, Scotty. But I didn't think that was very reverent, so I thought I'd just kind of leave that to the side. So right before he ascended, he told them, he said, you will be my witnesses, and you're not going to be my witnesses until you receive power, and you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. So the followers of Christ, they left the Mount of Olives, they walked back to Jerusalem, they're meeting together constantly, it says in the book of Acts chapter 1, in prayer together, and they're going to worship God in the temple in Jerusalem, and they're waiting and praying, and they're expecting, they're uniting together in prayer. They're knitting their hearts together, and they're growing in expectation of saying, what are we going to do now? What does Jesus have for us to do now? Now, on a human level, if I were one of the followers of Jesus, and maybe it was Doubting Thomas, because he's famous for his little skeptical attitude about things, but maybe one of the other apostles or the other followers, I might be thinking and asking some of these questions. Let's say you're in day 7 and you're waiting and praying and there's still no coming of the Holy Spirit. And now it's day 8 and still the Holy Spirit hasn't come. And now it's day 9. I might start really asking these questions and thinking like, hey, can we really do this? Can we really be Jesus's witnesses to this culture and this world? I mean, look where we were, guys, 50 days ago. The night that Jesus was betrayed up on the Mount of Olives in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus was praying with his followers, that night that the Jewish soldiers came to arrest Jesus and to bring him into custody, you know, Peter, of course, he starts off really well, and he says, Lord, is it time to fight for you now? And he grabs his sword, and he tries to cut off the head of somebody, and he misses, and he only got his ear. And Jesus healed the man's ear, and he said, Peter, put away your sword, because the kingdom of God is not going to grow that way by violence. He says, it says, those who live by the sword will die by the sword. And so Peter put his sword away, and they carted Jesus away. And then it says in Matthew's gospel, it says, all of his disciples deserted him and fled. Now that was only 50 days before. So that's not that much time period has gone by. They might start doubting themselves or asking this question, can we really pull this off? Can we really do this and carry on this kingdom business without Jesus, our leader, right here among us? They knew what they needed to do. They knew that they needed God badly. They knew they needed to depend on God. And so they went back into the upper room, and they were together, and they were united together, and they were praying, and they were saying, come, Holy Spirit, Jesus, fulfill your word. And so now we get to Acts chapter 2, and it's 10 days after Jesus' ascension into heaven, and the disciples are all prayed up, and they're expecting something big to happen, and something big was about to happen, because now it is Sunday morning. And that's, by the way, that's one reason why we worship on Sunday morning and perhaps on Saturday night, because it is the Lord's Day, it is Resurrection Day, and it happened to be the first day of the week, and this is the day that the church began. And so it's Sunday morning, it's late in the spring, it's during the time of a spring harvest, a festival, a gathering of all the Jews. It was called Pentecost. Pentecost comes from the number 50. So it's 50 days after the Passover Sabbath, and it is there in Jerusalem. All the Jews were required to attend these annual festivals, and they were Jews from all over the Roman Empire that had gathered together, and this is late in May. And it happened to be, by the way, it happened to be the easiest, safest time for any Jewish pilgrim to travel to Jerusalem from anywhere else in the empire. Because early in the spring for Passover, the seas were more dangerous. In the fall for the Feast of Tabernacles, it was more dangerous to travel. The safest time to travel was right here late in the spring. And so you had a large number of Jews from all over the Roman Empire. It says they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. And so we arrive on this first Sunday of Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, in verse 2, it says they were all together in one place. And verse 2 says, suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. So not a violent wind itself, but a sound that reminded them of a violent rushing wind. That is what came into the room. And so miraculously, there's this audible sound that was filling their ears, and they knew something big was happening. And then it says after that, it says, they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. And so this fire came from heaven. We just sang that in one of the worship songs. Fire came down from heaven visible to their eyes, and the fire separated, and individual little flames of fire came to rest on each one of the 120 Christ followers. And so there's an audible miracle, there's a visible miracle, and now there's something else that happens. It says, verse 4, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in other tongues or other languages as the Spirit enabled them. Wow, I want to show you a map. You'll see this map. It comes from my NIV study Bible, and I pulled out my iPhone and I snapped a picture, and look at the high-tech capabilities that are in this church. So you see that up there, it has countries of people mentioned at Pentecost, and it shows Jerusalem, and then it shows all of these arrows coming from all these different directions. There were gathered in Jerusalem at this time faithful, God-fearing Jews. You knew they were God-fearing because they were there for the Feast of Pentecost at that time. These were the faithful Jews. These weren't the, you know, Saturday-only Jews. These were the Jews that worshiped God and followed His law as faithfully as they could, and that's why they were gathered in Jerusalem to the temple at that time. They were gathered from all over the Roman Empire, from Parthia in the east, from Pontus and Bithynia and Lycaonium, and Asia, and Rome, and Egypt, and Cyrene. You remember the Simon of Cyrene? He was the man who carried the cross for Jesus up to the cross over there in northern Africa. That was a region. They were Jews from all these different regions. And here's the thing. Probably what many of them had in common, many of them spoke Aramaic. Some of them probably spoke Greek, because that was the common language in the Roman Empire. Some of them spoke Latin. Perhaps some of them even spoke Hebrew, the language of the Hebrew Scriptures. But one of the things that they did not have in common was all these people who were born in all different regions of the Roman Empire, they all had different languages. And in certain ways, they did not understand each other. But here's the miracle. The miracle was, verse 7, it says, utterly amazed, this large gathering of Jews who hear this violent rushing sound, they see these things that look like tongues of fire over the Christ followers, they hear them speaking in different languages, and it says, utterly amazed, they ask, aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own language? They were all hearing the praises of God in their own language. It was like a reversal of the Tower of Babel in Genesis. In Genesis chapter 11, what happened was it wasn't God's people. It was a people that were rebelling against God. They were proud of themselves, and they were building this big city and this tower. And God realized that this unification they had by having only one common language in the world at that time, that was going to be a problem to them rebelling against God and uniting against Him. So God in judgment says, I'm going to separate them by confusing them, by giving all these different groups of people different languages. And confusion is the word that is meant by the word Babel. So it was a place of confusion. And so since the men and women couldn't understand each other on the tower after God judged them, they separated and filled the earth. And so now the earth had all these languages. And God, what He was doing now was a reversal, because there were barriers. There were linguistic barriers between groups of people. And God says, I don't want there to be barriers anymore. I want you to be able to communicate. I want you to be able to understand each other. Because this message about Jesus being the Savior of the world and the Messiah for all peoples, that needs to be communicated to everyone, and language can no longer be a barrier. So God built bridges miraculously by allowing His followers to speak these languages that were only known by certain Jews that were in that audience. I imagine that it says that supernaturally, with God's power, these Christ followers could speak these other foreign languages fluently, though they never studied it, and they are now declaring the wonders of God. So it wasn't just that they were saying, hey, how's it going? You know, what'd you have for breakfast? That wasn't what was being communicated. What they were saying perfectly in these foreign languages, they were declaring the wonders of God. I imagine that these people were saying phrases like, God is so awesome and mighty. God is so worthy of our praise. Jesus, You are glorified. You are reigning at the right hand of the Father in heaven. Thank You, Jesus, for sending Your Holy Spirit. God is moving in our world today. Jesus is victorious over sin and death, and now we have the Holy Spirit's power. Jesus' promise has come true. All praise to God. They are saying the praises and the wonders of God. And people, if they spoke a foreign language, whether it was Egyptian or Parthian or Latin or Syrian or some other language that was unknown there in Jerusalem, those people could hear those praises of God in their own native language. And of course, that made the people just drop their jaw in awe and wondered. And many people were asking the question. He said, this is some kind of miracle. This is a sign. This is a wonder. But what does it mean? What does it mean? What is God trying to say to us through this miracle of language and being able to communicate? And so now God taps Peter on the shoulder, and Peter stands up. And of course, Peter is God's spokesman. He's the leader of the band. He's the leader of the apostles. And he's the one that's always ready to stand up for Jesus, whether he stuck his foot in his mouth or not. Now Peter is being filled with the Holy Spirit, and he's not going to stick his foot in his mouth at all. He's going to declare the truth of what God's message is for these people. So God directs Peter to stand up and explain what God was all about here and what God was trying to say to them. And so for the rest of this chapter in Acts chapter 2, we pretty much have this message of Peter to this crowd of people. So what was Peter's overall message? What was he trying to say overall? First of all, this miraculous communication that you guys are hearing, you're hearing this praises of God in your own native language, that points to God, who's authenticating that Jesus really is His Son and Jesus really is the Messiah that He sent to you. Another thing is that God did not leave Jesus in the grave. God raised him from the dead, and he's now ascended into heaven, and he said he would send his Holy Spirit, and he really did do that. And then the third point, which is why God allowed the language to be understood by everybody in the room, even though they all spoke different languages, was that the third point was that everyone needs to hear. Everyone needs to understand. This good news message is for everyone, and it doesn't matter what ethnic background you're from. It doesn't matter what language you speak. It doesn't matter from what part of the world you're from. The good news needs to be communicated to you too, so that you also can respond in faith to the good news message about Jesus. And so let's go over Peter's message in a little bit more detail. I see about 4 points that Peter was trying to say, again, on the day of Pentecost to this huge Jewish audience who is now sitting or standing in rapt attention saying, "You tell us what this means." The first thing that Peter does is he says, you know what? You remember all those Old Testament prophets in our scriptures? Many of them predicted the coming of Messiah. Many of them predicted what would happen in these last days, in the time of the kingdom of God with the coming of Messiah. Guess what? This time is being fulfilled. And so God said through the prophet Joel, he said, "In the last days, God will pour out his spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. In those days, I will pour out my spirit on all my servants, men and women alike, and they will prophesy." The Holy Spirit of God was released, and he's working through all his servants, men and women, young and old. They're all prophesying. They're all speaking by the power of God. So he's working through all his servants, not just a chosen few. And then check out this amazing promise at the end of Joel's prophecy. He says this, and you know what? In response to that, God pouring out his spirit says, "Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." Everyone, anybody who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, because this gift that God was pouring out, this gift was for everyone. So that's the first point. The second point is Peter turns the attention to Jesus. He's saying, "You just saw a miracle. This is what this miracle means. God has poured out his spirit on all people, on us. And that's why we could do what we did, speaking miraculously in your own native language." The second point that Peter's making is, go back to Jesus. Jesus really was the Messiah. He did a public ministry around many of you. You were here. Many of you guys were living in Israel at the time. You knew what Jesus said. You knew what he did. You knew that he was not just an ordinary man or a teacher or a prophet. This man was raising the dead. This man was healing the sick. He was expelling demons. He was making the lame walk. He was calming the seas. He was feeding multitudes with just a few loaves of bread and fish. Jesus did all that. Jesus even raised the dead. He raised a young girl named Talitha in Galilee. He raised a man who lives only 2 or 3 miles from here, a man named Lazarus in Bethany. He raised them from the dead, and you guys were witnesses of this. Many of you saw these miracles happening. But in spite of that, in spite of seeing these miracles, the leadership of Israel, the Jewish leaders, they rejected Jesus as their Messiah. As John says in his gospel, he came to his own people, and even his own people did not receive him. And so instead of welcoming Jesus as Messiah and ushering in the kingdom of God, the Jewish leaders rejected Jesus, and they turned him over to Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor, to have him executed. They were guilty. The Jewish leaders were guilty of rejecting God's Messiah. But in spite of all that, it was part of God's plan, and God even used their rejection to complete his plan, because according to the scriptures, the Christ, the Messiah, had to suffer for the sins of the people, and he was going to usher in their forgiveness and salvation. So that was point number two. Point number three is that Jesus did not stay dead. He didn't stay in the tomb. His resurrection happened, and God raised Jesus from the dead to fulfill God's promise that God said, you know what? I'm not going to leave Messiah in the grave. I'm not going to let him rot. Even the Jewish leaders' plans to kill Jesus and stop his movement, that didn't work, because God released Jesus, quote, God released Jesus from the horrors of death and raised him back to life again, for death could not keep him in his grip. Even David was a great king of Israel in the United Monarchy, the time of Israel's glory, 1,000 years before. David was also a prophet, and David was speaking far into the future and speaking about Messiah. And David wrote, "My body rests in hope, for you will not leave my soul among the dead. You, O Lord, will not allow your Holy One to rot in the grave." David said, God said he's not going to let his Messiah rot in the grave. He's not going to let him stay dead. He's going to raise him from the dead. So one of David's descendants would sit on his throne, and David looked ahead and spoke of the resurrection of Messiah, that God would not abandon Jesus to the grave. And then finally, Peter gets near the end of his message, and he says, you know what? God did. God raised up Jesus. And guess what? The people here that are also being able to speak miraculously, we're all witnesses of that. We all saw Jesus alive. If you want to ask if he's really alive again, we're here to testify, because we spoke with him. We ate with him. We drank with him. We heard his teaching. We saw him ascend up into heaven only 10 days ago. We are eyewitnesses of this fact, Peter says in Acts chapter 2. And then finally, Peter does what every good preacher does. Peter preaches, he gives them God's word, he tells them what it means, and then he says, you know what? It's time for a response. You people need to respond to this message of good news that you're hearing today. Because Peter, you know what, the way I picture it is, Peter's getting ready to conclude his message, and if he was on a modern stage and he was holding a microphone, he's got one thing left to say to the people. I got one thing left. And so in verse 36, Peter says this, "So then, therefore, let it be clearly known by everyone in Israel," all you Jews that are in this audience today and everyone in Israel, "let it be clearly known that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, God has made him both Lord and Messiah." And then I picture Peter just standing there, dropping the mic, going boom, and getting ready to walk away, and said, you know what? The ball's in your court, people. You're going to have to deal with that, because you, as God's people, were supposed to receive the Messiah, and instead of receiving him, you rejected him. On the day when Pontius Pilate came to judge Jesus, he actually had the opportunity to say, do you want, during the Passover, there was a special mercy poured out by the Roman government, and they said, we're going to let one prisoner go. Which prisoner do you want us to let to be released? Do you want it to be Jesus over here? He seems like a good guy. I interviewed him. I don't think he did anything wrong. Or do you want this guy over here who's an insurrectionist and a murderer and a revolutionary who would kill me now if his hands weren't bound? This man named Barabbas. Do you want me to release Jesus or Barabbas? And the Jewish crowd all looked and said, release Barabbas. Seriously? Him? Yeah, release Barabbas. Well, then what do you want me to do with Jesus? Nail him to a cross, crucify him, get rid of him. We don't want him anymore. Shall I crucify your king? And then the Jews said, we have no king but Caesar, which wasn't even true in their theology. They just lied in front of the Roman governor for no better reason than to say, would you please put this man to death? Jesus came to his own, and his own rejected him. And so Peter is reminding the crowd. He said, God, not like you people, in the crowd, God has made Jesus, whom you crucified, God has made him both Lord and Christ. Now, what are you going to do with it? And it says that the people felt completely, deeply convicted. They were guilty. They knew. They said, oh my gosh, we rejected Jesus. He was God's Messiah, and we turned our backs on him, and we had a Roman governor put him to death. We rejected the Messiah. We are in such trouble with God. We are in hot water deluxe. What are we going to do? How are we ever going to make this right with God? And so the Jewish crowd goes back to Peter and says, brothers, what should we do? How are we ever going to make this right with God? Is there ever a chance that God would even think about forgiving us for what we've done? And Peter says, all right, here's what you need to do. Peter's words convicted them deeply. They said, "Brothers, what should we do?" And Peter replied, each of you must turn from your sins and turn to God and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peter says, I'll tell you what you need to do. You need to do at least two things. And here's the action points for us today. Because the message that Peter spoke 2,000 years ago in Jerusalem is the same Christian message that comes to us today. Peter said, you need to do two things to get right with God. You need to repent. You need to turn away from your sin. You need to turn away from whatever attitude you had that did not make God first place in your life. You need to turn away from that, and you need to turn back and start walking toward God. You need to repent. And then the second action that you need to do is you need to be baptized. Be baptized. Wait a minute. Be baptized. I'll tell you from my story, I was baptized. I don't know how old I was, maybe a month or 2 or 3 months old. My parents took me in a little white gown, according to the pictures, because I don't remember it. They took me in a little white gown, and they brought me before the pastor in this congregational church in Wichita, Kansas, and he said some words over me, and he says, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And that was the baptism that I understood. That was a sprinkling. The word that's being used here by Peter is not a word that means sprinkling. It's not a word that means pouring. It's a word that means immersed. It means to dip or to plunge completely under the water. And Peter says, I want all of you people to turn back from your sin to God, and I want you to be willing to make a public stand. I want you to publicly declare your loyalty and your allegiance to follow Jesus as Messiah, and I want you to identify, I want you to get into a tub of water or a river or whatever the source of water was, and I want you to be willing to be completely dunked under the water as a symbol that you are dying to your old way of life. You are saying goodbye to my past. I'm not going to do whatever I did before. I'm going to put Jesus first place in my life, and I'm going to start following him. And this public declaration is my pledge of allegiance to Jesus. So you're going to be dunked under the water, and you're going to come up out of the water, that just as Jesus did not stay dead in the grave, so you too are going to walk in a brand new life, from death to life, from death to burial to resurrection. And that baptism is going to symbolize that. Now, how many of you guys are willing to do that? And the audience said, well, because this is what it said here, it said, those who received, this is in Acts chapter 2 and verse 41, those who received Peter's message were baptized, and get this, they were baptized that day, the same day. Did they have a 4-week catechism class? No. Did they have to take a course on what Christian baptism means? No. They believed the message. They turned from their sin to God. They confessed Jesus publicly as their Lord and Savior, and they were baptized that day. And about 3,000 people were added to the church that day. It went from being a church of 120 to an instant megachurch. Pretty cool. Only the Spirit of God could do that. Only God could do that. And we're going to talk about next week, because it's really interesting. You go from a church of 120 to a church of 3,000. You think you might have some problems. You think you might have some issues and challenges. 3,000 brand new baby Christian followers of Jesus. How are we going to live this new life? What are we supposed to do? We're going to talk about that next week. So please come back for that. So I want to talk to you just one more minute about this issue of baptism, because friends, at some point in your life and in my life, some point God has clearly communicated his good news message to you. And maybe today could be the first time that you've heard this message and really understood who Jesus is and what his death on the cross means and what I'm supposed to do if I believe this message, and how am I supposed to respond the way God wants me to respond. God's told you that he loves you. He's told you that Jesus is his son. He's told you that you can have new life, and the way to respond to God in faith, according to Peter's command, is you are to repent and you are to be baptized. So now you might be wondering all this stuff, and you say, okay, I believe all this, but baptism might have been something that happened to me as a baby, or maybe you weren't even baptized at all. But why are you talking about baptism? Why aren't you just talking about faith? Why aren't you just talking about believing in Jesus? Because that's the key to everything, isn't it? Well, yes, it is. But I talk about a relationship with Lisa. We've been married 32 years now. When Lisa and I were dating, I said Lisa and I are, quote, in a relationship. This is pre-Facebook, right? So we were in a relationship, and then we were dating. And then I finally told her that I loved her. And then I finally asked her to marry me. And she, for some, you know, crazy reason, she said, okay, why not? So she decides to marry me. And then we planned a wedding, because the wedding was the public announcement that I was going to be her husband for life, exclusively faithful to her, and she was going to be exclusively faithful to me until death separates us. And those were our vows that we shared with each other in front of God and in front of all of our family and friends. That was my public declaration that I was going to be united to her as my wife and as her husband for the rest of our lives. Baptism is kind of like that. Baptism is like saying, you know what? I'm getting serious with God. I'm going to respond to God in the way that He said. And so the first point about baptism that you should know, why should you or why should I be baptized, is because baptism is for believers. It's not for babies. You read anywhere in the New Testament where somebody got baptized, they heard the good news message, they believed the message, and they were ready to respond to God. They knew what they were doing. A baby cannot say that. Baptism expresses publicly what you've already experienced personally as you committed your life to follow Jesus. So baptism is for believers. The second reason why be baptized, Jesus Himself was baptized. I told you earlier, when He started His ministry, He walked 65 miles from His village in Nazareth, where He is working as a carpenter, put down His carpenter tools. It says, it's time to start my public ministry and tell the world who I am and tell the world that the kingdom of God is near. And so Jesus did that, and He walked out. And how did He start His ministry? By publicly being baptized by John, whom we know as John the Baptist. So Jesus Himself was baptized. The third reason is Jesus commands us to be baptized. It's not just here in Acts chapter 2. It's in Matthew's gospel in the Great Commission, where Jesus says, go and make disciples of all nations, all ethnic group, people everywhere. Go and make disciples of them. And the first thing you're going to do once they become believers, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, demonstrating that you really are a Christ follower because you're willing to do what Jesus commanded us to do. So there's reasons. So who should be baptized? Well, who should be baptized? Every person who's committed to follow Jesus should be baptized. When should I be baptized? Well, what's the example that we read here in Acts chapter 2? They said about 3,000 people responded to Peter's message, and about 3,000 people were baptized into Christ that day, the same day. There was no delay. There was no class. There was no reason why they should wait. They should be, if they are ready to commit their lives to follow Christ, then they should be baptized. So what I'd like you to do is, in your welcome card here, I have to believe that in a room this size with a people this size, that there's a number of people who have yet to make certain decisions to follow Jesus Christ. And maybe today could be one of these days where you take a big next step spiritually, where you say, you know what, this is where I am today, but I am ready to take a step forward, and I'm ready to become a more faithful follower of Jesus Christ. Maybe it's believing in Christ for the first time. If that's what happens, I'm making a decision today to follow Jesus. You circle that on the back of the card. Maybe you're making a decision, you say, you know what, I don't know why, for whatever reason, I haven't been baptized yet as a believer, immersed into Christ. But we have a baptistry, a pool of water up there, and next week we could baptize you if you're ready to do that. I had a man come up to me and hand me a card at the end of the last service, say, you know what, I'm ready to be baptized. We're going to baptize him next week, praise God. So maybe there's other people that are ready to be baptized into Christ. Maybe you want to become a member of this church, of Sebastopol Christian. You want to make this your home church and join God's family in this local congregation. Maybe that's a decision you want to make. If so, circle the statement about membership. Whatever the step is for you, take a next step spiritually forward. do something with this message. Just say, I am going to be more faithful. If it's for no other reason to say, I've taken all of those steps, I'm plugged in. What about joining a life group? What about saying, I'm ready to circle up with other groups of believers? I'm ready to study the Bible together. I'm ready to pray for each other. I'm ready to share my story and be known by other people so they can lift me up in prayer, so we can do life together, so that I can grow with some circle of new Christian friends. Maybe that's your next step. Whatever the next step is, take a next step spiritually. Will you please bow your heads in prayer with me as we close? Lord, we want to honor you today, and we've read about you ascending into heaven and giving these commands to your followers and saying you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon us, and we will be your witnesses. And Lord, we saw how your followers, early followers there in Jerusalem, how they, when they waited and they prayed and united together, they received the coming of the Holy Spirit, and they went out and they shared you everywhere they went. That message has come all the way down to us today. And Lord, your word tells us that the faith comes by hearing the message and believing the message. And so Lord, we've heard this message about who you are and what you mean in our lives and what you want us to do. You want us to repent. You want us to be baptized. You want us to follow you with all of our hearts. So Lord, I pray that whatever that next step is, whether it's to believe in you, whether it's to commit to follow you in baptism, whether it's to join this church, whether it is to join a life group, whether it's to come out of the pews and say, I'm ready to serve, I'm ready to devote myself and give some hours a week to help build up this church and help a ministry out. Lord, whatever those steps are, we pray that you'd speak to each of our hearts, that our hearts would be open to you, and that we'd be willing to do what you are asking us to do. Because, Lord, that's how we grow. We know that's how we grow, when we say yes to you. So I pray, Lord, whatever you're calling us, that we would say yes. And we ask these prayers together in Jesus' name. Amen.